Hello, Vital Sign. Today I'd like to talk about a fascinating type of number, Stirling partition numbers, or Stirling numbers of the second kind. Now, these numbers are really important to the fields of combinatorics and discrete math. Stirling partition numbers tell us the number of ways we can group the elements of a set of n objects into k non-empty subsets. Grouping elements of a set into non-empty subsets is also called partitioning a set. There are several notations for these numbers, but here's the one we'll be using in this video. SNK, which denotes the number of partitions of a set of n objects into k non-empty subsets. Another way to think of Stirling partition numbers would be the number of ways to distribute n distinct objects into k identical boxes, such that no box is ever empty. From this viewpoint, the boxes are subsets, and the distinct objects are the elements in our set. I'd like you to think about this simple problem. How many ways can we distribute 7 distinct objects into 4 identical boxes? To solve the problem, we should understand how to calculate partition numbers ourselves. Let's think about how this works with some small sets. Imagine we have a set of 1 element. How many ways can we distribute this element into 1 non-empty subset? Well, there's only one way to do it, which is to place our only element into that subset. This means that S11 equals 1. Can we partition our set of 1 element into 2 non-empty subsets? No, we can never partition a set of n elements into more non-empty subsets than the number of elements we have in our set. So S12 equals 0, because there are 0 ways to do this. And in fact, S1k for all k greater than 1 is also equal to 0. Now think about a set of 2 elements. There's only one way we can distribute these elements into one non-empty subset, which is to include all of our elements in that subset. Remember that the order they appear in does not matter, as we're counting partitions, not permutations. All that matters is which elements are paired with which other element in the same subset. There's also only one way we can partition the set of 2 elements into 2 non-empty subsets. That is, we can split the red dot from the green dot, placing each in its own subset. So S22 equals 1. And as before, when we tried to split the set of 1 element into 2 non-empty subsets, there is no way we can partition the set of 2 elements into more than 2 non-empty subsets. We can generalize what we just discovered above to SNK equals 0 when k is greater than n, or k equals 0 for all n greater than 0. This is simply because we can't partition a set into more non-empty subsets than we have elements in that set to begin with. Another identity would be that SNK equals 1 when k equals n or k equals 1, as there's only one way to partition a set into one non-empty subset, that is, placing all of your elements into that subset, and only one way to partition a set into n non-empty subsets, which is to place each element of your set into its own subset. Now comes the fun part. We can make an array of these numbers with the column number representing k and row number representing n. We have a lot of unknowns on our table right now. It is possible to find any SNK using an explicit formula shown here, which we'll cover in depth in one of our future videos. For this video, we'll use a recursive formula shown above. What this means is that the number of ways to partition a set of, say, 3 elements into 2 non-empty subsets, or S32, equals the number of ways to partition a set of 2 elements into 1 non-empty subset, plus double the number of ways to partition a 2-element set into 2 non-empty subsets, or S32 equals S21 plus double S22. Feel free to pause and think about why that is, and then I'll give you some intuition about this formula in a second. So here's why this formula works, and you can see our recursive formula is also up here at the top right. Suppose we have a set of n elements, and suppose that we know all of the partitions of n elements into k non-empty subsets. Remember that there are SNK ways to partition the set of n elements into k subsets. So we have SNK, different configurations here of n into k subsets. Now consider what happens when we add an element. All of those partitions are still valid as long as we include the new element into the subsets that we already have here. In fact, For each given partition of n into k, we can form k new valid partitions of n plus 1 into k. That means that for each partition, we can create k additional partitions. This gives us the second term in our recursive formula, k times snk. Note that this is not complete. We still have our first term to cover. We could place our additional element into its own subset. The issue is that the partitions from S and K are no longer valid, since now we're using up one of those K subsets for our new additional element. However, the partitions S, N, K minus 1 still remain valid as partitions of the N plus 1 set into K non-empty subsets, as long as our additional element occupies its own subset. And with that, we've now covered all possibilities. Either the additional element is in its own subset, or it's not in its own subset. And we've just covered the intuition for both cases. So that gives us the first and second terms of our recursive formula. We can enter this recursive formula into our spreadsheet, and we will quickly have our answer to how many ways we can distribute 7 distinct objects into 4 identical boxes. I encourage you to work out the solution for yourself. So there are 350 ways to distribute 7 unique items into 4 identical boxes such that no box is empty. Now, aren't we glad we didn't have to count out all those possibilities ourselves? Thank you for watching this video. I hope you'll tune in for my future videos in the combinatorics series, where we'll look at the intuition behind combinations and permutations, cell numbers, and related to this video, we'll dig into this nasty looking formula here, which gives us any S and K. Please subscribe, like, comment, and share with your friends. Have a fantastic day.